So welcome everybody. Today we have Karin Skapski, who's going to present our regular feature of what's new in Microsoft 365, formerly known as Office 365. Then next up we will have Sean Walbert and Kyle Lancaster presenting a summary of the Microsoft SharePoint Conference 2020. This is the virtual conference that took place May 19th to 21st. So they're going to walk through and sort of give us an update of what's new, what happened. Save us spending 3 days of our life attending the conference. As we're doing virtual meetups at this point, we have decided that we're going to carry on through the summer. In past years, we have taken a break for July and August, but seeing no one can go on vacation or do anything or go anywhere, we thought we might as well keep the knowledge sharing going and have a meetup for July and August. So hopefully if you're around, you're able to join us. With that being said, we're going to do that on July 29th at noon, the normal day and time. We will have our regular feature of what's new, most likely done by Karin, unless she's booked vacation that I'm unaware of. And then the other part of our session, we are going to do 3 in 30 again. We've done that in the past. It seemed fairly popular and successful, so we're going to give that a go. We've got several topics we're floating at this point that we think people would be interested in, so I'll get that posted quickly here. After this webinar, and then people can sign up, get it in your calendars. And with that, we are at noon, and hopefully, oh, and there's Sean. Yeah. Hopefully Karin is ready to go. So Karen's gonna go first, and then we're gonna have Sean and Kyle. Thanks, Karin.
Beautiful, okay. So does it look like the normal what's new in Microsoft 365 right now?
It does.
Perfect, okay. This edition of What's New in Microsoft 365 is brought to you by a special feature in PowerPoint called Cutout People. This morning, while we were putting some finishing touches on the slides, I was looking for a stock image in Microsoft's stock image library. And found this Cutout People tab that I'd never seen before. So, of course, Sean fully encouraged me to have fun and get creative. So you'll notice that this version of What's New in Microsoft 365 is a little more colorful than most. And I hope you enjoy. Okay, so first, what's new is that sensitivity labels features are either generally available or will be generally available soon. So what's available now is auto application of those labels to content in OneDrive and in SharePoint, and as well as Exchange. What's coming soon is sensitivity labels in Microsoft Teams, Microsoft 365 groups, and SharePoint sites. So that is set to be complete early July. This feature requires E5 licensing, and then there are a couple other compliance information protection licenses that support it. But exciting to see these features coming. The auto application of labels makes it so much easier to keep your content classified how it should be, so without putting too much of the load on the end user. So excited to see that. And of course, excited to see the capabilities coming to Teams and all of the other tools that we use.
That kid looks very excited too.
Next, we have basic formatting on branded sign-in text. So if you are familiar with the login screen for Microsoft 365, which I imagine all of you are, you can brand it with your company logo, background image, and then a little bit of text at the bottom. We always like to do this for our customers, not only because it looks great, but also because it helps prevent you against phishing attacks. If you're logging in and you're used to seeing your organization's imagery and then you don't see it, that's a good flag. So really what it is it's just the text at the very bottom is getting rich formatting. And ours says, for support, ask for 2 hits if you dare. 2 hits is Steph's nickname. We can talk about that another time, but it's kind of a 1-2 punch thing.
Anti-Irene.
Okay, next.
Oh, who's this?
Pardon?
Who's this? Yeah.
This is a this is a doctor. This is a doctor who is endorsing that this is exactly what 100 gigs looks like visually. So file size in OneDrive and SharePoint. So the maximum file that you can upload used to be 15 gigs. It's increased to 100 gigs now, which is huge. So this is available now. They did add a little caveat in there saying that they recommend uploading very large files using the desktop client. So I imagine the web version, not super reliable, but this is awesome because I don't even need to say because it's awesome. We have the communication site experience on Classic Teams coming. You can apply this through a PowerShell commandlet. It's gradually rolling out to targeted release by the end of June, and the rollout will be complete by end of July for all customers. So it helps you get that modern experience without, you know, if your company really can't migrate, then it still lets you get some of that good new look and feel. We also have default page templates coming to SharePoint Online. These will let people choose one of the page templates and make it the default. This is rolling out to targeted release in mid-June and then to standard release late June. So I guess mid-June has already passed, complete by mid-July.
That's timely too.
Yeah, definitely. there are a few updates to lists and libraries. I imagine, you know, coming along with the new SharePoint list, the new Microsoft lists. So a couple updates to SharePoint lists and libraries are with Quick Edit. First one is that you'll be able to open a list or library item within the form while you're in Quick Edit. You can also just completely fully edit the list and library forms when you're inside of Quick Edit, and you can create new list items through Quick Edit. There are also some updates coming to the list sharing experience. These updates are basically giving us what we have for document sharing right now with document libraries. So bringing that functionality to SharePoint lists. Functionality that was there before in Classic experience. So excited to see that coming. The timeline for that is rolling out early July for targeted release, complete by mid-July. And then for standard release, rolling out mid-July and complete by the end of July. Next feature coming to SharePoint Online, some updates to the look and feel of lists, including, selection is more how you use it, just user experience, really. You'll be able to set a fixed row height if you wish. There is also a new way of interacting with selecting multiple rows. And some other just little visual updates, like those little color bars that align with the theme. One that is very subtle but very helpful is they're adding a add new item button at the bottom of a quick edit view. And so if you have a list that you're adding items to in quick edit, then you will no longer have to scroll all the way up. It's just right down there where you're using it. I mean, previously you could enter it into an empty line, but
that wasn't very intuitive.
It makes sense. Sure. No, definitely not. Yeah. We have some personal features coming to Teams Mobile. We think that part of this is, you know, Microsoft just trying to take over the world, trying to get everybody into Teams, whether it's, you know, they're using it personally and then they want to start using it at work. I personally think that this is a little bit of a strategic move with G Suite, really, because you know, everyone I know who collaborates on things, personal things, family things, none of them are really using Microsoft. So this brings a lot more of that home, family, friends functionality to Teams. So we get text chat, video calling, possibly an omen that Skype consumer is on its way out. We get lists, documents, calendars, collaboration. We get a location sharing feature. And then the last thing is a team safe. This team safe allows you to securely store your passwords and any other sensitive information. And then you can share it, say, like share the Wi-Fi password with your family. It's protected by two-factor authentication and end-to-end encryption. So nice and secure. But I know Sean had some thoughts on this the last time we talked. Did you come to any?
I think it's brilliant now. I mean, when we saw it the other day, creating another vault and kind of trusting that vault with Microsoft. I don't know. I'm not sure how I felt about that, but make your comment about Gmail and G Suite and targeting the individual and giving them one place to go for everything. I think it's good. It's good for families to use Teams. I could definitely use it to manage the annual Christmas party with 17 people put into our house and arguing what to eat. But also, all the things that my family needs, they're still relying on email. This is about killing email. This is about killing poor communications and putting something better in place. So I think this will be actually a really big deal. I'm surprised they actually aren't making more noise about it yet. But maybe they're just taking it for a spin.
Mm-hmm. It's exciting. Yeah, we'll see. I believe the general availability for that is expected by the end of the year. So next announcement, Microsoft Teams. They are doing away with the general channel system messages and replacing it with an information pane. So general channel system messages are the picture on the left. We've all seen them. On the right, that's what the information pane will look like. It'll also show recent activity, who's doing what, how many members. So I personally, I've never been very attached to the general channel system messages, so I'm happy as long as we have a way to see it that isn't having to go too much into the back end or run any reports. I'm happy. Sean, what are your thoughts?
It looks way better. It's less of an analytical log and more actually informational on what's going on. I suspect actually there'll be an option in the future where the general channel could be a dashboard and the general channel is locked. It's really just for introducing the purpose of the team and like being an overview of what the team's for and then using channels properly, whether the channel per topic. I'm seeing lots of teams out there where the only channel is a general channel, and that's not really the intent of the product. So lock down that general channel, use it as a top-down communications thing, and maybe if this went full screen inside that channel as well as an option, and maybe some a nice introductory graphic, and it's more like a home page for each channel. I could see that happening.
I could definitely see that happening too. And it would be great to be able to access the channels more easily now that the breadcrumbs are still gone. And so I still find it super awkward to have to navigate back to the settings for the team or, try to find it on my list of teams on the left side. So that'd be cool. That's an interesting prediction, Sean, that a home kind of home page.
It'll be recorded. We'll play this back in 6 months.
You've heard it here first, folks.
Yeah. I think I'll stop talking.
No, let's go back. Keep talking, please. This is what the folks are here for.
I could see, along with that, eventually having an option where when you open a channel, you decide what tab to appear in. Like in some channels, I may not want to go to the conversation pane. I might want it to be secondary to something else that channel actually its function is. So it'd be interesting to see if that follows suit with some sort of channel dashboard.
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah, I agree. Because, it makes sense, obviously, for there to be that general channel that's locked for top-down messaging. But with a lot of organizations that are smaller, that might not necessarily have a ton of, different streams of information, if they could just pick what's created. And so, I don't know. I mean, even just naming it something, I don't know. It would be nice if it was an option. So I totally agree. Okay, so next announcement. I couldn't find a picture of what this is supposed to look like, so I imagine they're still working on the UI, but we will soon be able to pin posts to channels. This is something that a lot of people have asked us about, so I'm excited for it. This is a setting that can be set on the channel for the team. Rolling out for standard release, beginning of July, complete mid-July. For government, mid-August, complete end of August.
That makes a lot of sense too. Just like in Facebook group, some sort of announcement for the channel that needs to be sticky at the top. That'd be awesome. Mm-hmm.
Interesting. I wonder how that plays in with general.
Yeah.
Hmm. We'll have to play. Okay. Yep. Some Outlook, actually just one Outlook announcement. Microsoft is releasing, what are they calling it? Roaming signatures. So what this is your signatures that you set in Outlook previously that were tied to your computer can now be tied to your email account. So it can be applied from wherever. Initially, when this was announced, I thought maybe this would kill services like Exclaimer, but it doesn't look like there's any way to centrally manage user signatures. So I think they're still good for now. They're a service that we love and use with a lot of people, so and use personally. So good to see that they still add value there. And of course, so the another concern with that though is, you know, how those third-party plugins will be affected, and they are releasing a registry value that you can change for users to stop this from rolling out so that it doesn't break everything. Last announcement, To-Do is bringing in the option to share your personal lists seamlessly. So what this is going to do is let people within, so when you're at work, you can join, modify, view, add data in a personal to-do list. So, you know, you could very well share your own personal to-do list from home with your work account. And then if you are at work and you remember, I've got to pick up those groceries on the way home, maybe you can add your apples to there or whatever. I'm curious, like, what information is shared between those? Because, you know, if you have any interesting doctor's appointments or things you might not necessarily want work to know about, but we'll have to see what that's like. That is coming, actually it's rolling out right now and it should be complete by mid-July.
And that'll complete the loop for the stuff that Wunderlist used to provide that To-Do took for
Regroove. Yes.
What is happening there? That's awesome.
So this is obviously not me, but it's just the mascot. She was the one at the beginning of the presentation. She's at the end. I don't know, just with the cutout people. I thought it was a really, really wacky feature. I don't know how you could use those in a serious way, but if it adds some levity to your slides, then I'm all for it. Awesome. Okay, so that's it for what's new in Microsoft 365. I will hand the stage over to Sean and Kyle.
Karin, we need to make that part of our regular slide deck going forward. People
Agreed.
I should mention that it was Sean who egged me on into doing that. So.
Awesome. I'm giving away the presentation already. Awesome. Thanks, Karin. So Sean and I are here to talk about Microsoft Build, all the fun announcements that they made. There's been lots of stuff, and the most exciting stuff to us right out of the gate was stuff in Teams. So that's where we're going to start. I'm sure some of you may have been looking up things or heard things or you know, we got a little bit of a preview from Karin's update. But if there's stuff you're excited about, let us know. You can type it in the chat. And here's the stuff that we think is cool. So in Teams, some new stuff that was announced, some app search improvements. And that's just going to make it easier to find things. I don't know. We've all tried to find stuff in Teams and it can be tough to try to figure out, to have the AI figure out what you're looking for. So they're implementing some new stuff in search that should make that easier. And for bookings, bookings is awesome. It's going to be great. You can should be able to get in there now. For a while, it was really tough to get in. You had to like sign up for it, even though it was free, and they had to send you an email confirmation. And there's all kinds of tough things to get going, but now it should be pretty straightforward. And if you are in last month's user group, Don from View Royal gave a whole presentation about bookings and how they're using it. It's a great tool for just letting people book your time. You can just say, my calendar is open from this time to this time, and people can just book either appointments, like if they want to book, you can set up specific things. Like if View Royal is using it for come in and hand in your property tax documents, so that you can book a 10-minute meeting there, and people can just start filling in your calendar as you have it open, and then you know that you have things rolling in. You can charge for those appointments if you want to. So like things like, I don't know, there was like a bunch of examples for like massage places or physical therapy, using them to book different physical therapists and things like that. So it seems like a really cool feature.
Initially it was, they used hair salons as an example. That was pre-COVID, obviously. But, we're using it quite successfully in the office right now to book desks so that we know who's actually staying at what desks, so we have to limit who's coming into the office and knowing for contact tracing who was in and when. Just to go back in the search one too, yep. Basically it's Control F is what everyone's waiting for in Teams. Being able to do a Control F and find stuff. They used to say in Yammer, you know, if you put things in Yammer, you put it there because you didn't care about it anymore, and you just it would disappear.
It's just gone into the abyss.
As awesome as Teams is, I found the search has been where like search is not strong in Teams. So
I'm popping. Definitely in. Looking.
Karin's back.
Hey, I'm back. I'm here. I recently published a blog post on how to find what you need to find in Teams after multiple people at Regroove, mostly Nicole, but other people too, would just always come to me if they needed to find something. Hey, Karin, do you know where that thing went? And I could always find it. They're like, what, are you a wizard? No, not wizardry, just a few tricks. So I will drop the link to that blog post in the chat. Okay, thanks, guys.
Awesome. Take that, Microsoft. We've got Karin's blog. So they did announce that at Build, Karin would be writing a new blog, so that feature is finally out. what do we got here? Power Platform integrations. So what that long terminology is basically they're making it easier for bots and flows and dashboards to be part of Teams. So I was reading some places where you can have bots like personal at mention people specifically, and like a bunch of different cool things that bots can start doing. Templates. So Teams templates, you can they're going to start rolling out like industry specific templates or general templates for Teams, so that you don't have to build a team from scratch. There'll be options, and they'll come with channels and like little description of channels, like what kind of content could go there. So that could be super useful for people that maybe new to Teams and not have any idea where to even begin. There'll be templates that you can choose from instead of just start from scratch. Sean, have you looked at those at all? Do you have any thoughts on those?
No, actually, well, my thoughts, no, that, yeah, we talked about this, didn't we? Mm-hmm. Bingo. There's a product called coming called Orchestry by a friend of mine in Vancouver, Michael Pisarek, and you know, should watch for that. Microsoft's templates thing is going to be, you know, it's going to be good in like a framework, but this Orchestry thing is going to be mind-blowing for projects. So we're going to be an early adopter, and it'll revolutionize how we build teams and projects. So I think his website right now, it's orchestry.com. I'm guessing it's still just saying coming soon, but I've seen it, and it's coming soon. It's going to be fantastic. So
awesome. Watch for Orchestry. That. Nice. Fluid I had in here, but took out, but now I put it back in because I looked up a little bit more about it. And what it seems like is it's kind of their take on Google Docs, how it's less of like, this is a Word document, or this is an Excel file, or this is a blah, 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 and more of just like, you are just creating documents or spreadsheets in a space together. So it seems like that's going to be their take on like Google Docs, kind of like what Karin had said earlier about Everyone's kind of using Google Docs as just kind of a way to share things with friends or family. It seems like it's going to be a way to kind of just make it easier so you don't have to worry about what kind of document it is. It's just all there and can be shared in Teams or wherever you want to put it. Live meetings. This is exciting. Since we started doing these in LiveStorm, these webinars, everyone has been, why aren't we using live meetings? And we had our reasons to kick it off. LiveStorm was a good tool for us to use at the beginning of the lockdown and the social distancing. But we feel like live meetings has really come a long way in the short amount of time. And that's been one of the themes from Build, is just like everything has been advancing so fast. So we personally have gotten working with View Royal, and they're getting council meetings set up through Teams live meetings, so people can watch the council meetings from home, or counselors can take part in the council meeting from home. So that'll be cool, and we're getting started on another municipality here in the Capital Region, so they'll be starting live meetings for their things as well, and this should hopefully be the last user group meeting that we'll do in LiveStorm, and we'll start doing live meetings for this event as well. Lots of cool features there, so we're excited to get going on those. The big thing that we did want to talk about today was lists. Lists is a way, SharePoint lists have always been awesome, but it looks like lists is going to blow up and just make lists available in Teams, in SharePoint. They're going to have their own app for it, and they look like they're going to be beautiful. So we've got a little video. I should have really put that last, but Project Cortex is just the announcement for more AI and cooler functionality coming from Microsoft with AI. So let's go here. This was kind of just, that was our cool, exciting thing that we were pumped about. There's lots of the Azure stuff too, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But this was just kind of like, you know, we're also, Microsoft's doing security things. They're locking down security because the cloud is secure, but always improving it to make it better. Windows has more updates coming out. Edge and Bing, like Sean said, like Bing, we're hoping one day will be good, but I don't think we're there yet. But you've been really satisfied with Edge, hey?
Well, look, Google is the new Firefox, which is means it's been relegated to being my testing browser. So, which means IE is, well, I just don't open IE at all anymore. But yeah, Edge Chromium has been fantastic. If you watch the CPU usage compared to Chrome, it performs better, it crashes less. And when it does crash, it crashes faster, so you can get back to work. Their extension store is growing, plus you can use all the Google extensions. And they're not watching what I do. So I kind of like that Microsoft's taken a much less invasive approach to using their browser. And the fact that it's rolled out into Windows 10 means desktops of the future, all those steps that an IT person had to do to provision a desktop, we just eliminated a bunch, because the first step usually was download a better browser, install it, change the search engine to Google. Now you're just going to open up Windows 10, open the browser, and change the search engine to Google. So, because.
Yeah. Awesome. Ian had mentioned that there was an announcement about changes to Windows 10 that could mean the end of dual booting Windows and Linux machines. And yeah, it does look like Linux is going to integrate much easier within Windows. So that's exciting for those of us that use Linux in that manner. So Microsoft Lists, this is what we're looking at. So they've got their own standalone app with this. It'll still be in SharePoint, but it'll be more pretty. You can do these big image banner icon things, big graph. And then you can also put it straight into Teams. So that's going to be exciting as well. I'm going to advance this slide. I don't know if it'll look choppy in the video, but this should be their announcement video that they have for Lists. I don't know if the sound is traveling either, but it's just jazzy jams, so you can imagine your own jams. Yeah, just imagine that over and over again.
Oh, I was muted. I was singing Girl from Ipanema when you queued up the jazz stuff. Yeah, it's probably good in a weird way.
Boom. So as you can see, they're excited. We're excited. It looks like it's going to be cool. So lists will be the way that we create, share, and track. They already pretty much are the way to create, share, and track information, but it's just going to open it up to a much broader audience. With being able to put them in teams with the bright, pretty colors and the jazzy. I hope the jazzy tracks come with it too. Anytime you open it in Teams, just get that. This is something that we are that we're excited about too, and we think that lists is going to really drive home for us. So, Sean, do you want to talk about this slide a little bit?
Sure. Yeah, this is just kind of a concept that we're playing with, and it's more just about education with customers. And businesses and within interdepartments, the idea that, you know, once you're in the cloud and you transition all your tech away and you can now actually start gluing systems together and start looking back at what processes you have and making them better. Should it be a spreadsheet or should it be a form that goes into something and then there's reporting? The Matt said once, you know, when in doubt, cite it out. So, you know, in the old days, navigation in SharePoint, for example, people would create one site collection and use the inbuilt SharePoint nav, and it sucked. And it forced you into design approaches that you shouldn't really take. So the good news now is because we're online, we can create as many site collections as we want. If you have some sort of purpose or problem you need to solve, you should be giving it a dedicated site because you can always link to it from others and get to it through Site Hub nav or whatever nav mechanism you use. But, you know, always create a separate container for it. Create a site collection because it's a logical security boundary. It's a functionality boundary where you can turn on features in it that are unique and won't damage other people's stuff. So when in doubt, cite it out. Once you've built a solution, so say you built some sort of process for tracking checks or something, the next thing you need to do is page it out. Well, you've got these beautiful SharePoint communication sites and pages where you're going to explain how that process works. So basically introduce it to staff as like a news announcement, provide details on how it works, maybe chuck a video in there that you've recorded, how people would utilize the new system, store it and stream. So we've now cited it out, we paged it out, but then you need to point it out. This is where I, you know, me personally, I think this is where Navo sings, the product we make, but really you don't need Navo to tell people how to find things if you're going to use the Site Hub infrastructure or Teams tabs or whatever, but, you know, basically help people find it. So just because you announced it doesn't mean they're going to remember where they found it. And anybody new to an organization is not going to know where it is either. So pretty much every time we're creating a solution for a customer now, we talk about citing it out, paging it out, and pointing it out. This also looks like, I think this is the French flag. So
yeah, when we made this slide, I was like, this looks like a national flag of some sort.
Yeah, I don't know if red's on the left or right, but anyway, it wasn't intended. But it's a repeatable concept and one that you can sell to people, and lists would be a big part of that. Actually, lists are, frankly, what they're doing with the lists, you could sort of do already. They're just making it hot and easily accessible, and they're making an app to find it. In traditional Microsoft case, though, they're creating an app that's going to have 1,000 lists in it, and people are going to wonder what list is for what, and is this list active? So it still doesn't really solve the problem of actually getting around and finding things well, but these lists are gorgeous. The conditional formatting is stunning. And it's going to definitely bring SharePoint. Well, I mean, SharePoint's still the plumbing at the end of the day. It's been relegated to plumbing, and we're bringing that plumbing in a gorgeous way. But there you go. I'm out of words. I'll stop talking.
Yeah. Look at this plumbing. This is excellent looking plumbing. So here they're just showcasing. They've got it in a channel. They've added it to a tab. They've just called an event itinerary, and they've got everything charted out. The session names, they've got session codes in here. But nice visual styles for session type. The little bubbles look nice. And then they've also got speakers so that you can like personalize, add people to it and give their little bubbles. Like just the formatting and style here is really pretty. And if you're like me, you're like, the first thing I did when I saw all this is like, what is the difference between to-do and planner and now tasks? It seems like there's so many things that are very similar. And somebody had laid it out like, and I'll lay it out for you. To-do is for personal lightweight task management for yourself. And planner is for the team task management. And tasks, these things, are going to be task management for the team within teams to help manage and prioritize work that's generated. And you can take tasks from across every Microsoft thing, whether it's Planner or To-Do or anything like that, if you're using Trello, and just kind of a way to manage all of that together with everybody. So just like there's going to be templates in Teams, they're going to put templates into tasks as well. So for some of their basic templates here, they've got new hires, event itineraries, business trips, asset managers. So it won't be like complete shock of how do I use this program? What is this? They're going to have templates built in there so you can use a template or start from scratch. So that's pretty good on their part. And I thought this was really cool. You can just add images with one click, like Karin displayed with the people icons there. They've also added a in SharePoint, you can see the stock. There's a stock photo option in there now. And Sean and I were looking at that the other day, and then there are really beautiful options in there. There's really cool stuff. And it looks like with lists, they're bringing visuals into this as well. And you can make really visual lists by easily adding images to it. So these are some of the Azure things in the Azure department. So we've got the hybrid and infrastructure, just a bunch of backend awesome upgrades. Sean, do you have anything that you wanted to add before I get too far into this? I just realized I skipped over the end of that.
On lists? No, I rambled.
Plenty, yeah.
So.
Okay. awesome. So new Azure Stack Hub updates, they're going to simplify resource management, machine learning, virtual desktops. So you'll be able to do those kind of processes much faster. There's lots of cool new updates with their AI that's coming out. The new model, it's going to be able to assess fairness better, apparently, enable the development of more accurate and fair models whenever the AI is building out models. And they've apparently partnered with Microsoft's Harvard Institute of Quantitative School of Science to make some cool updates there. Mixed reality and Internet of Things, those are very interesting. We all know that Internet of Things is just constantly expanding, and more and more security points, more and more risk, if that is the best word for it. So they are aware of that, and they're trying to make it more integrated and make lots of cool new advancements there. Dev tools and services, lots of backend things. I'm sure if this isn't really my specialty, so I'm sure if Sean, do you have anything to add into these categories here?
Internet of Things for sure is very interesting. Actually, and this is just on a side note to everybody on this call, when you're building your wireless networks at home, build your own wireless network. Don't use your ISP's router wireless, because at some point they're going to swap it, and you're going to have so many devices that you need to go update. So I'm at a condo in Parksville right now, and she's got crappy Wi-Fi, but I offered to replace it for her. So got the Google Nest mesh for her place here, and putting that wireless network in front of that ISP router, because I still had to walk around and redo her door lock, her camera, her doorbell, TVs, her Nest Hub, and her Roku. So that was like 2 hours of work, all because the wireless network would have changed. So do not connect to the Shaw networks or the TELUS routers that they're giving you. Create your own mesh network, own your wireless, and build from that, because you're going to be adding devices all the time. In our house, we have 74 IP devices now. So I'm glad I did that way back when. Anyway, Internet of Things is coming, and it's coming in lots of different ways. Own and control your wireless. Don't use someone else's kit. There you go.
Yep.
Public service.
I'm just about to go through that process myself. I'm swapping over internet providers. So that should be fun. I'm about to embark on that personally.
Well, we'll talk about that. Let me get you on the right place.
All right, sounds good. At Quantum and Supercomputer, there was some really cool like sketch videos talking about their new supercomputer. It's one of the top five in the whole world for quantum computing and doing some really cool new things there. So that was pretty fun. So that's all we have from Build. I saw a bunch of people commenting and chatting about the stuff that they were most interested in and really liked. So thank you. Keep up the good conversations there, everybody. Sean had one more thing that he wanted to show. Do we still have time for that, Sean?
Yeah, I figured we'd probably end reasonably early. So if people aren't interested, that's cool. But I thought I would show a little thing I discovered in PowerPoint. I didn't discover it. It's been there for a while, but use cases for it, and I thought I'd share it. So I'm going to share my screen, and I'm going to choose this screen. So anyone that has seen me talk about stuff recently knows that I actually, like, I've been using PowerPoint since I think the day it came out. That's how old I am. And used to do everything in PowerPoint. I don't actually use PowerPoint for making presentations anymore. I use Beautiful AI, which if you've ever seen it, it's stunning and is awesome. So I actually use PowerPoint more like a whiteboard or storytelling if I need a graphic. And that's partly because if I'm going to spend time in Photoshop, it just takes too long. And sometimes I just need to get into it. So let's talk about ideas here for a second. When we're talking about something, and you know, Kyle and I are helping View Royal put together a live meeting broadcast system for their council. And so that has all sorts of moving parts, and meetings have to be absolutely seamless and need specialized hardware and placement and instructions and stuff. So at the end of the day, they're going to have this big table at the front of the room, and that's where the mayor sits and the people. And they have, you know, microphones on. Oh, that's not what I wanted. They have microphones on it. You know what? I'm going to grab a microphone. So we'll go into clip art here and grab icons. And I'll just do mic. Bear with me here for a second, because some of this you've probably, this is nothing new, but I want to show one thing once this is kind of mapped out. There's a microphone. Great. I'm going to insert it. And actually, I'll just put two of them there. There's more people than that on the council. And then there's a table on the left, and it's going to be there. And there was a special computer there. I'm not even going to worry about drawing that. I will format this guy though. So when you present images to people and you're trying to give them a concept, sometimes they get fixated on the colors, or they're like, our microphones don't look like that. They get caught up in the details. Our room isn't gray or whatever. So, believe it or not, I find a lot of times I have to actually like back it off. So the idea of making these things all sketch-like, if I choose all these shapes and I go to shape outline, this has been around for a little while now, is this sketched item, at which point I can actually convert all these to more like sketch-like things. And actually, you can do it to these. Oh no, you have to, that's a trick I learned. You have to convert to shape. And now that it's a shape, I can even make the microphone sketched. So at that point, it's a little more, maybe I'll make it bigger so you can see it. But the idea being it, making it more conversational, more casual, getting people to actually like just talking about what we're talking about, rather than worrying about it's not the right system, or you throw a picture of a PC on there and, oh, it's actually a laptop. Like, I don't care about those details yet. We're not at that point.
It's the napkin sketch.
Yeah, exactly, right? It really makes it like an app. And there's lots of apps out there that do that kind of stuff, but really, we've all got PowerPoint, and this is just a click away. The other thing that I've been big on for years, and anyone that has seen me teach old office stuff, I love myself some smart art. And so, you know, if I were to create a process, I can quickly throw some smart art in here, and I can change its colors and make that and pop this out here. And, you know, maybe my process is go to pub, have a beer, have another, maybe another, fall down, get home safe, right? So that's my process. Picture's worth 1,000 words, that looks great. I like the idea of making this a sketch too, because I don't want to like be committed to this process yet. This is just for conversation. The problem is you can't just click here and say, switch to sketched. Text outline is not an option. But what you can do, same kind of deal, is convert to shapes. And then you have to actually break the, get it the way you like it first before you do these steps. Come on. Click. There we go. You want to ungroup them. And now I can actually control A the whole thing. And I should be able to do my sketched. Yeah. Right? So even that, I can make that process discussion conversational as well. Anyway, I think that's kind of cool. And just built into PowerPoint. I think it's only in PowerPoint. I never actually checked in Word. My guess is it's not there. Anyway. Hope that helps someone. I think having a conversation about designing stuff, whether it's citing it out, map paging it out, and pointing it out, these are the kind of conversations we have to have rather than getting caught up in the minutia.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So there's a freebie. With that, I'm done. How about you, Kyle?
I'm good. I'm wrapped up.
All right. Awesome. I see a couple people filled out our poll. I think two people did. Oh, no, we got three now. Have you switched to Edge Chromium yet? We got one yes, one nope, and one nope, never. Ooh, never.
Solid.
That's cool. Okay, thanks for coming. I will stop talking.
All right, thanks, everybody. Hope that was useful. Just a reminder, Wednesday, July 29th will be our next session with What's New and 3 in 30. So I'll post that and sign up, and we'll see you then. Stay safe. Be well. Take care.
Yeah.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.